Hello, I'm W.T. Edmonson, and welcome to Focus. Freedom often calls unbelievable silence. The aim of Focus is to educate, motivate, and of course, to inform the community to action. Well, cancer seemingly are becoming more pervasive, and in recent times, there seem to be more and more survivors as well. It wasn't long ago that I only knew a few people that had been diagnosed with cancer. But recently, I've known quite a few. We have with us a few sisters who have been diagnosed with cancer, and they have experienced the treatment and coming out of treatment. So we have them with us today, and they're going to share a little bit of their experiences. Hopefully something that they say will be of encouragement to others. October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. And so I have chosen to invite four friends of mine to come and share their experience with cancer. Our guests, Ms. Liz Morrow, Ms. Wendy Woodard, Ms. Andrea Hendricks, and Ms. Lily Moulton. Let me correct that. Reverend Andrea Hendricks and Reverend Lily Moulton. Okay. They're going to share a little bit of their personal information with you, and then we will get right into a few questions. And let's start with Ms. Woodard.
Yes.
As you prepare yourself, calm down.
Thank you.
Please share a little bit about yourself and when you were first diagnosed and what was that diagnosis?
A little bit about me. I am currently a 25-year Missouri State employee. I am also a proud cross-country mom. This is our season now, of a student athlete son. And I am a thriving, surviving TNBC, which stands for triple negative breast cancer survivor. I wanted to also add to that warrior because I am still currently fighting. I was diagnosed April 2017, actually I can say April the 6th. I had detected something in March, actually March 30th, and was able to get into my physician's office March 31st. And it went rapidly from there. I mean, literally, I was having an ultrasound that afternoon. I had scheduled that Friday. That was when I was at her office and literally was in a office for a biopsy that April 4th, 2017. And 2 days later, I was getting that phone call. And I would say that hearing, and we didn't even know the actual term yet. She called me saying very quietly, and it's such, to know that your doctor is so compassionate, they didn't even want to tell you the words to confirm what we were suspecting in her office. It just is so overwhelming. And it takes me back to that moment right now, and it just kind of a little bit unsettling. But in that, it was such a process where, like I said, everything was moving quickly. And the next day, literally, I was at an oncologist's office by suggestion of family that I had spoken with.
Okay. Ms. Morrow.
Yes, sir.
Tell us a little bit about yourself. And when were you first diagnosed? And what was that diagnosis?
I'm Ms. Morrow, better known as Liz to mostly everyone that I come into contact with. I'm the current director of alumni relations and annual funds at Lincoln University. I was first diagnosed on December the 5th, 2017. And prior to that diagnosis, anyone would have found me in the gym 5 times a week doing planks, challenges, burpee challenges, any kind of challenges that I could do. And I was diagnosed with invasive ductal carcinoma breast cancer.
Okay. Reverend Hendricks.
Yes, Reverend Hendricks, exact. I'm a mother of three. I'm a wife of a wonderful husband of 26 years. My background is business and finance. I'm currently working as marketing engineer at ABB. I was first diagnosed with breast cancer on February 9th, 2018. I found out that I had breast cancer by way of a car accident. I did not have any symptoms. I did not, everything was fine. I was the busy person. I would have never ever expected anything such as that. So when I went into, I had the car accident and I was rear-ended. And so with the accident, the impact was so drastic that it caused the cancer to push forward to be seen in a mammogram. Otherwise, it would not have shown up. And so when I had the car accident, I was thinking that the seatbelt from the left to the right was what was causing the pain, but it was on my right side, and so I couldn't figure out, well, where is the pain coming from? And so I thought it was just bruised tissue, but again, with the impact, nothing hit me, so I didn't expect that it was anything. And so I was already scheduled for my mammogram, and so when I went in for the mammogram, I told her, I said, well, be extra sensitive because I know that it was going to hurt. And so she was like, well, it's just probably bruised tissue. 2 days later, they called me. They said, we found 2 spots on your right breast. And so we're going to have to come in and do a biopsy. And so I did that, came in, and I was sitting at home. I was working. And at 2:35 p.m., I was sitting at my desk and I got the phone call from a nurse telling me over the phone that I had breast cancer. Mm-hmm. And so, that was extremely devastating.
Reverend Moulton.
Yes. I am the mother of 2 sons. My elder son is a pastor. And I'm retired, thank God. And I was diagnosed with cancer in August of 18. There was a call to my job, and my doctor is very emotional, and it was kind of hard for him to tell me. Mm-hmm. And so I just said, well, just tell me what's going on. So he said that they had found spots in both sides of my breasts, both breasts, and for me to come in. So that started it all of how I found out that I had breast cancer.
General question. After having received that message, hearing the words that you never thought you would hear, what was your immediate response? You can respond anyone.
Well, my immediate response was, I turned back, and luckily there was another manager in the store at the time. And I told her, I says, you know, I need to go home. And I went home. And I just stayed to myself and prayed. And I was thinking, what, me? Why me? That something had invaded me that could be a killer. That my mom had, and my father, both. So I stayed to myself and I prayed and I prayed. And I heard. And I finally came to myself and I thought, it's like, how do I tell my kids this? How do I hurt my children and tell them that I have cancer? So then I thought, I says, I'm not going to let them touch him. I would just have to die with this. Finally, I built up enough nerve after talking to God and being to myself to tell my sister, and decided from there to have cancer. But I felt invaded.
Vanessa?
I would say your emotions are raw. I guess I pressed her when I think back on her being hesitant, referring to my physician. She didn't want to tell me like that. She wanted me to come into the office. But already, you're calling me on my cell phone. I already suspect this is not good news. So literally, I had just gotten out of my vehicle heading to my workplace. So that was a long walk to my building in tears. And I'm thinking, you need to go home. But at the same time, I felt like I need to be around somebody because I don't need to be alone. And the emotions and the thoughts, just as Reverend Moulton said, I mean, everything is just bubbling inside and a lot of questions are coming up. But that other part of me is saying, you've got to get busy. You've got to get busy. You've got some work to do. You do. You have to find out some information. And to be honest, at that time, she said, literally, I have a surgeon I want you to talk to. And I said, you know what? I need to call you back once I get my thinking cap on. I need to call you back because I need to figure out some things right now. And when I make a decision about a surgeon, I will definitely contact you.
Andrea.
Well, for me, it was a blessing. That day I received the phone call. Both my mom and my husband was there. When I got the phone call, you know, we were home laughing and playing. Like I said, I was working, and it was a usual day. And I wasn't expecting to get the phone call until that Monday, but they called me on that Friday. And so I said, oh, this is quick, you know, they're just calling me. And so immediately I called my husband, and he was playing, and like, you know, what do you want, you know? And he came in, he sat in my office at home, and he said, what's going on? And I said, I have breast cancer. And the facial expression, I mean, was just, it was extremely difficult because I didn't know how to respond to it. But I was glad that they were home with me because again, I could not have accepted that news with being home alone or by myself. And so it was like, it was, God knew. He knew exactly what I needed. And I was devastated. I felt like my world was ending. I was thinking immediately about my family. It was just everything that I had not done, and was this going to be the end, you know? Immediately went into defeat mode, but I was so grateful because I had such an amazing support around me to pull me out of all of that. And my kids, although they were devastated with the news, they were absolutely amazing. I have some little warriors, and they were amazing. They were absolutely amazing. And so,
Liz.
All right. I was fortunate enough to be in the doctor's office when I got my diagnosis. My mother was with me because I had my biopsy the day before. So when the doctor told me, the doctor, which is also my friend, gave me that news, I immediately started crying, and I picked up my cell phone and just dialed my best friend, and I told her, and we cried together. And in the midst of crying, I dried up those tears, and I looked at my mom, and I asked her, was I the first one in the family to have this? And she says, yes. And I said, that's okay. That's all right. I said, because cancer, I am going to tell on you. I am going to go live. I'm ready to tell everyone that I come into contact with. Cancer, you got the right, but the wrong one this time. Mm.
So that's when you decided to actually go total public?
Yes, sir.
The first, when you were diagnosed?
Yes, sir. Mm. That day, something overcame me. It was just like the voice of God saying, you have to share this story with everyone. How can I be administrator at Lincoln University? At that time, I was a university registrar, and these students telling them, you know, if they close to graduating and they miss a class, that you can't stop now, you can't give up, you have to fight. And I didn't take on the role of being a fighter.
After being diagnosed and having your quiet time together and with family and friends, at what point did your doctors tell you what your options were? And how did you decide which option you would take? Reverend Moten.
Well, it was after I was diagnosed, we went to family reunion, and I discussed it with my family, told my children, came back, and then the doctors approached me as to what it was, or the procedures in which they wanted to take, and that was removing both breasts. Because cancer was in both breasts, and both breasts had a different type of cancer. Okay. So we just had a discussion. I had a discussion with my kids, and I told them, and I came to the point where it's that right now, even though I'm talking to you, I'm going to be selfish, and this is my decision. And I talked to God, and I told him, I say, this is yours. You always told me that I didn't have a fight. So I gave it to God, and that was my decision.
Okay. Andrea?
Like I said, I was extremely blessed because I was surrounded by such amazing friends and family. And so the doctors, they immediately gave me the different options. And so after going to the first, I was originally here at Capital Region. But then my family, because everyone is pretty much in St. Louis, they wanted me to be closer home, so that's when we decided to go to Siteman Cancer Center. And so that's when I got a second opinion. And then with the doctor, she was really amazing that after her explaining things to me, because you know, after you talk to so many doctors, it's just that it's their routine. There's no really personable, it's not really personable. And so, but once I encountered this particular doctor, she was absolutely amazing, and she sat down. She took her time to explain all the different options. But even though they gave me all the options, I immediately knew exactly what I was going to do because I did not want to experience this again. So that's when I decided that I was going to have a double mastectomy and then do the reconstruction surgery later because I could not fathom in my mind to have to repeat this process, even though the chances are still likely, is less likely with the double mastectomy. So that's why I chose that route.
Liz?
I too had a big support group. So I had a family full of doctors, nurses, preachers, anything, and administrative assistants. Dr. Light is the surgeon that I had, and she basically just wrote everything out, every procedure, explained everything to our family, answered all of our questions. And after that, my family was pretty much comfortable with, everything she explained. And we just said basically after the chemo, because I started chemo first, we would decide what procedure will be best. But I was open-minded to whatever it take, whatever, I had to do. I didn't have a set, like, I only have to have this or I can't do that. I just said whatever to spare my life, I was going to do it. But I was fortunate enough just to have a lumpectomy because it was in my right breast at 9 o'clock, but it had also spread to my lymph nodes. So I had to remove 10, in which 2 was positive.
Winnie?
Yes. Initially, the thought was it was IBC, inflammatory breast cancer. So with the type of bruising and redness and swelling that was being seen, that was the thought. So we're talking about aggressive. And in that, that puts you in another category, even mentally, to be even having that on the forefront. But going forward, we, as she would say, let's dial this back. We're removing that label. And instead, I ended up finding out I'm triple negative breast cancer patient. So therefore, I have no hormone therapy that I can receive as some cancer patients would be able to, because the negative is the word. Mm. I do not coincide with that. So yes, triple negative breast cancer is a little bit more difficult, but treatable. Mm. So that's the good news, mm-hmm. and I'm here because of that. Yes.
Mm-hmm. How long were you in treatment, and what is your current prognosis?
I was in treatment from April 27th until December 5th, and the reason I'm saying it in that capacity is I'm also including my surgery and my radiation, my 30 treatments of that. So literally from that time frame all the way, a lot was going on that summer, that year. Mm-hmm. For me, currently, when I got finished with chemotherapy, I want to say that would have been the early part of August, I was finally stage 1. From stage 3 and the grade 3. It's just amazing. Everything's grades and stages, mm-hmm. okay? And of course, grade 3, like school, it is not a good thing, okay? The higher, the more negative. But in that, got to all of that, and here I am now still doing quarterly testing. And I thought I was in my second year of going forward here, because I finally got to stage 0 when I completed my 30 treatments of radiation. So that was a wonderful time to find out those results. However, because of the type of cancer and grades and stages that I obtained, I'm still getting quarterly testing from her. So we're trying not to see a reoccurrence at this time, even despite my mastectomy. I chose that right now. You're toggling, and I'm hearing the various surgeries, but you're toggling about, it's a huge decision to make about what do you do with your body in order to become well. Mm-hmm. So that's where I am right now, but happily going forward with aligning myself with these quarterly tests as I should, and making sure that I do what I need to, but also making sure that I allow her to make sure I'm well.
Okay. Liz?
My treatment started December the 27th, 2018 with the chemo. I went until April 4th, 2018. I had surgery May 16th, 2018. I let my body heal and relax because I then too had to go into 30 rounds of radiation as well as physical therapy, which started July 2nd. I had therapy and radiation going simultaneously. So my last radiation treatment was August the 15th, 2018, and I am currently a one-year survivor.
Amen, yes. Amen, amen. Andrea.
Yes, my whole everything started on April 6th. Well, we buried my sister-in-law on April 5th. We had my surgery on April 6th. And then I started my chemo in May of 2018, and that lasted, I had major complications with that, and that lasted until September, and then in October, I went into radiation. I had 30 rounds of radiation. Then after that, it was a horrible process. I had third-degree burn with my radiation, so that had to take some time to heal. Then I went into surgery again that following February, and relapse after relapse. I had three surgeries in the month of March. Month of March, I had three surgeries. And then I went into recovery, and I didn't begin to heal until June of this year. But I can proudly say that I am a one-year cancer survivor.
Amen. Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Prognosis.
At this time, 3 weeks ago, I rang the bell. I am cancer free.
All right.
And I just want to say that it's been a hard time from the beginning, even up until now. Mm-hmm. But, and everyone had mentioned their family, I didn't say, and I would like to say this, on the day that I had my surgery, and it was so many people there that I became afraid, and I asked God, I said, God, am I going to die? Because, you know, everyone showed up. But I would say that if you just give it all over to God, mm-hmm. and let it go, it makes it easier. Mm-hmm. And you make it to this point.
Yes.
And when you ring that bell,
yes.
it's something that it seems like the tone just goes down through your body,
yes.
because you are healed and your doctor is telling you mm-hmm. it's such a great feeling
yes.
that your body is cancer free.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Thank you all for sharing. Having gone through all that you've gone through, the pain that you have endured, family and friends praying with you, fearful for you, and I can only imagine the times that you spend alone, because sometimes I'm sure you just have to be alone.
Yes.
What would you share with persons having been diagnosed or undergoing treatment currently, or have been diagnosed cancer-free? I'm gonna let you go last because you're so public.
I would say, you said if you just found out, correct?
Mm-hmm.
You need to stop, take a deep breath, scream, cry, pray, and repeat. And not exactly in that order.
Mm.
Because right now is not the time to hold it in. You need to let it out because mm-hmm. stress is definitely not anything on your list to add to where you are right now, emotionally and physically and mentally. So the spiritual aspect, yes, I can't speak on anyone's religion, but whatever you need to reach out to at that point to keep you in a positive lane, find it immediately and hold on to it. Mm-hmm. If you are, just say, finished treatment?
Yeah, once you're cancer free.
Once you are cancer free.
Glory.
Living, loving, laughing. And I do mean that in a very real way. You just step forward and keep it moving. Enjoy your life and your friends and your family. And I've just been extremely thankful and appreciative to those that are still on this journey with me. It is something that humbles you. And I have bowed my head not just for prayer, but just for thanking those that you truly want to be independent, but there's a time you have to allow people to love on you and help you. And there's nothing negative about it. Mm-hmm. So that's not a time to look upon yourself as though there's something wrong. That's something good, because there are people rallying around you. Your village has come to love on you, and that's a wonderful thing. Mm-hmm. And I'm thankful for that.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Rev. Moulton.
Question.
Having gone through the process, what would you say to those who have been diagnosed, those who are going through treatment currently, and what would you say to those who have rang the bell?
The ones that has, excuse me, been diagnosed, I would say that you need to find yourself, realizing exactly what it is that you have and what must be done to save your life. Second question.
And those who have been diagnosed cancer-free.
You know, that puts a smile on my face to say that I went through a year of pain that I smiled every day. I never stopped smiling. I smiled. When people would see me, I was smiling. But I might be having the worst pain at that time. And like she said, that everybody doesn't depend on the same thing. But what I done was I just gave my eyes to God. I called on Him. I talked to Him. When I was hurting, I knew He already knew. And I just knew that I had to go through this for a reason. But to be diagnosed and then afterwards to be cancer-free just let me knew that He had something for me to do, that it wasn't over, that there was a purpose, and that I must complete this purpose. And that He did heal me for a reason. And happy I am, because I love life, yes. I want life, and I appreciate my life even more now than I did before I had this invasion that could have killed me.
Reverend Hendricks.
Wow, what would I say to the person that has been recently diagnosed? I would say that it is okay to feel how you feel. Oftentimes we try to mask how we feel so that everyone else around us can be okay. Yes. But if you get a tinge of craziness, that's okay too, you know?
Yeah.
You just have to be okay with not being okay, you know? Yes. And as you process your way through it, and everyone, as you can hear, everyone's story is different and they process everything different. And so your expectation, there shouldn't be an expectation on how you are supposed to deal with it. because it's your own way and you are uniquely different than everyone else, and it's okay. But you just have to maintain that positivity. Yes. I mean, as you go and well in the water, you can't stay there long, you know. You have to come back and you have to have your affirmations in place. I mean, for me, I had to write it on my mirror in my bathroom. Whenever I walk in the bathroom, I had to recite what I knew to be true, you know. Mm-hmm. And so whatever it takes for you, if it's your prayer life, if it's your own personal affirmations, whatever it is that you need to get through, then you put your battle plan together and you will get through it. But if you, there's no defeat in this, but you have to have the mindset that you are going to get through this.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And that will help you to overcome that. And for those that have rang the bell, and that for those that are survivors, it is an amazing feeling. Oh my God, it's just refreshing, renewing. It is just wonderful. When I look at the words, the live, the laugh, and the learn, that has a different meaning for me now, because I am living intentional. I'm intentional about everything. I make sure that before I leave, I tell my family how much I love them, how much they mean to me. I don't put things on the back burner anymore. As if I'm going to have that second chance. I have a second win at life, and so if nothing else, I'm going to love hard. I'm going to live hard. I'm going to laugh hard. And I'm going to play hard. I am going to do this. Yes. And life just has a different meaning that nothing can stop me. You know? You better watch out, world. I'm coming. I am on the way.
Liz.
All right.
You went public from day one.
From day one.
That tells you everyone's journey is different, and you have to do you, basically. Yes. So the first one, what would I share with persons having been diagnosed? Your journey would not be like my journey, and my journey might not be like yours. Mm-hmm. There are some journeys we might meet up in the middle, but basically do what's best for you, and I respect each and everyone's decision. But just know that I'm open and, you know, I'm here for everyone.
Yes.
The second, undergoing treatment, attitude is everything. Mm-hmm. And you have to speak over yourself. Death and life lies in the power of the tongue, and you have to speak life. Mm-hmm. And you have to fight. And having been diagnosed cancer-free, this is something that I had to do. I had to learn to love living life again.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Say a little bit more about that.
Basically, you know, when you get this diagnosis and it's like, cancer, you're trying to take me out. You
right.
know, what the devil meant for your bad, God turned around for your good. Yeah. But you go through this, even though I was positive and fighting, I was mad at cancer. Like, really? Mm-hmm. You know, I'm at the prime of my life. I'm finishing up my doctoral program. I just turned the big 5-0. Really? You coming for me? Mm-hmm. So that's why I took on that attitude. You got the right but the wrong one. But you take so much time fighting to whereas you're not living. You're fighting to live.
Mm-hmm.
So after you're done with that journey, then you have to start to love to live life again.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Well said.
Ladies, it has been a joy to sit here in the midst of what you have shared. Everyone needs to hear. Everyone goes through, if not cancer, something else.
Yeah, absolutely.
But the attitude that you all have brought to this, I'm sure will be a benefit to someone out there in the viewing audience. Closing comments. Anything that you said, I wish he had asked.
So, I have had probably from the beginning that it existed social media hesitancy. But I must say that if anyone's looking for resources, support groups, they are out there on social media. everyone doesn't want to sometimes go into the midst of strangers sometimes and to discuss themselves. It takes a big person to accept sitting at a round table discussing and revealing your situation. But there are support groups that exist for whatever area that fits you. It's right there. It's to me like the yellow pages of the internet, literally, when you can go out there and just type it in. And for those that don't have access, your local library has that information too. Your physician's office has that information, because I think initially you are so bogged down with so much information coming at you. Mm-hmm. You're so busy trying to get in tune with you. You're not reading. At least I wasn't reading. I'm listening, but then you also need an advocate to be with you on those doctor's visits. That is so, so important, because someone needs to be taking those notes. Someone needs to be addressing questions that sometimes you really are so wrapped up in what you're hearing about yourself. You're missing some things, and it's so important to have someone there advocating on your behalf. So I'm just saying that resources are available for anyone. We are in such a day and age that you're covered, you really are. So don't place yourself away from information. Mm-hmm. It's out there for the asking.
Liz?
1 in 8 will be diagnosed, mainly women, but men can get breast cancer too. Early detection is best. I encourage everyone to know your body, feel it. If it's anything that's abnormal, to get it checked out. And one of the regrets that I have is that I didn't have Aflac cancer insurance. I don't work for Aflac or anything like that, I'm just saying. But just by interacting with some of my pink sisters, as we call them, some had the Aflac insurance and some didn't, and it was a supplemental insurance. There's resources, like she said, that's out there. Believe it or not, I'm glad that I have cancer. I know that sounds crazy, because if I didn't, I wouldn't be able to meet these wonderful women and men that I've met. Cancer, there's a whole new world, but there's so many resources, and there's so much love and support with this, and been having this journey, going through this journey.
Thank you. Uh-huh. Andrea?
Yeah, I would like to say definitely there is a community of people. It's a cancer society. It's this own community within itself. Mm-hmm. And just the amazing support that you have and the people that are rallying around you to help you fight and to help you get through it. It's absolutely amazing. And, you know, it was different for me because I was always the one helping someone else. And so for me to have to exchange shoes was very difficult, but I had to learn to be vulnerable. Yes. I had to learn to allow people to help me.
Yes.
It was a different place for me. Mm-hmm. But mm-hmm. once I realized that, you know, that this is something you have to allow people to love on you.
Mm-hmm.
And I definitely needed that. And everyone that experiences any tragedies, they definitely need to be surrounded by the love and affection that is presented through the different avenues. Mm-hmm. So,
yes.
Milton?
I'll just say that open up and not close yourself off to the surrounding people that's there to help you. Mm-hmm. Because I did get into that position where I was just trying to shut myself down, opposed to allowing people to help me. And there were so many people that wanted to help. But like Liz said, I had pushed them back away from me. And then I had to come back and find me and said that this fight, because that's what I felt, that I was fighting such a battle. Mm-hmm. And while you're fighting, you don't have to fight by yourself, because even though a person said, well, how are you doing? I had gotten to the point where I was tired of answering that question all the time. But it wasn't like they were being invasive. It was just that they were caring. And you lose something. I don't know about everyone else, but I lost something. Whereas that I thought that people were just invading into my privacy, but I had to learn how to accept the fact that they were only trying to help because they knew what I was fighting was not a game, that it was serious. It was a life-threatening situation. So I say to all, just let people help you and do not shut down on society. Just let them help you.
Before we close, I'm sure that there's a doctor whose name is on the tip of your tongue because they mean so much to you.
Yes.
Share that name for us. Wendy?
Dr. Tamara Hopkins.
Okay. I have all my doctors. But I'm sorry.
You said one of them already. Yeah. That's my surgeon, too.
Okay, I have Dr. Deffenbaugh. Okay. I have Dr. Allen. Dr. Ekram. They're all phenomenal.
Yeah.
Yes. That's a great team.
Yes. Yeah.
Yes.
I will have to say Dr. Clover Collins and Dr. Nastala. My oncologist and my surgeon were amazing.
Yes.
Well, I'm in love with my doctors. Dr. Lynn, and they're all at JCMG. Dr. Lynn was my surgeon. And Dr. Stefan was the reconstructive surgeon. And Dr. Hadadon, and I might not be pronouncing it totally correctly, but he's just a little sweetie pie. I love all of them. And I thank them. And in fact, when I rang my bell, Dr. Hadadon was right there with me. And he said that I wasn't ringing it hard enough. So he grabbed the bell and we rang it together. So yes, okay. I love my doctors right here at JCMG.
All right,
yes.
All right.
I forgot one doctor, Dr. Light. And I was at Capital Region Hospital.
Yeah, I can relate to her. Right. Yes.
Ladies, it has been a rewarding experience to sit at this table with you. Thank you for your willingness to come to the table and share. There will be others who have gone through what you have gone through. And just by chance, they happen to view this program may give them just a little bit more encouragement.
That's my prayer.
Just a little bit more encouragement. God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
God is good. All right. Thank you for tuning in. Stay focused. We'll see you next time. God bless.
God bless you.
God bless you.
God bless you. God bless you.